The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 4048, the name Stuart McMillan, on Commonwealth Day 2017. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask members to leave the chamber quietly? With those members who wish to speak in the debate, please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate. Mr McMillan, 7 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, last week we had International Women's Day. On Friday, it's St Patrick's Day. And on Monday of this week, we had Commonwealth Day. Like the celebrations of the global achievements of women and the usually more exuberant affirmations of Irish identity, Commonwealth Day is marked across the globe, and not only in the 53 member countries of the modern Commonwealth. Commonwealth Day is an opportunity for individuals, communities and organisations to promote the Commonwealth's shared values of peace, democracy, equality and to celebrate the association's rich diversity. Now, having emerged from a group of countries that shared a connection with Britain, the modern Commonwealth has been based from the beginning in 1949 on the maintenance of fundamental values and principles. Since the 1949 declaration of the Commonwealth has regularly restated and refreshed those principles and values. Now, the Commonwealth comprises people from across all the continents of the world, and despite the incredible diversity of members of the Commonwealth, we are intrinsically linked through our common history. At a time of increasing instability and uncertainty in the world, with today marking, unfortunately, the sixth anniversary of the conflict in Syria starting, for example, the Commonwealth family of nations and its rich diversity becomes an ever more needed source of strength and hope for all its members. The theme of this year's Commonwealth Day is, of course, peacebuilding. Now, a peacebuilding Commonwealth is a natural follow-on from 2016's theme of an inclusive Commonwealth and reaffirms the Commonwealth Charter principle that international peace and security, sustainable economic growth and development and the rule of law are essential to the progress and prosperity of all. But the strength of the Commonwealth's commitment to its principles and values, including the promotion of human and political rights, has helped to give it a substantial and distinctive role in the international community. And the Commonwealth theme for 2016 celebrated the diversity of the Commonwealth, which is made up of more than 2 billion people. Now, every person is different, and each has something unique to offer. But the Commonwealth Charter asserts that everyone is equal and deserves to be treated fairly, whether they are rich or poor, without regard to their race, age, gender, belief, or other identity. And the Commonwealth builds a better world by including and respecting everybody and the richness of their personalities. The theme for this year informs events organised by governments, schools, community groups, and individuals to celebrate Commonwealth Day, and helps to guide activities by Commonwealth organisations throughout the year. Now, membership of the Commonwealth is widely seen as implying a guarantee that a country is upholding high standards in democracy and human rights. And Scotland remains a progressive, open, outward-looking, an inclusive nation and an internationalist country. And as a nation, we value our links with our Commonwealth cousins. And certainly through the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, this Parliament certainly plays its part in that. In my constituency of Greenock and Inverclyde, the Inverclyde Malawi Schools Partnership has been running since 2007 and links local schools with schools in the Chiradzulu district in Malawi. Now, last session, the Inverclyde Partner Schools supported a wide range of projects, including installing solar and mains electricity, provision of clean water, supporting feeding programmes, building classrooms and teachers' houses, and the formation, and I do particularly like this one, Presiding Officer, and the formation of the Malawi branch of the Greenock Morton Supporters Club. Now, I don't know how people would say monoton in the various Malawi languages, but I'm quite looking forward to learning at some point going forward. But 14 schools already have built strong partnerships with young people in Malawi. And not only does this help people in Malawi during difficult times, it also helps encourage our young people to see themselves as global citizens. Now, of the 2.4 billion people in the Commonwealth, 60% are youth and young people. So this shows the importance of these partnerships going forward. Now, in the spirit of friendship that brings the nations and territories of the Commonwealth together is evidenced by Scotland's connection with the late Nelson Mandela. The lessons of his life, his magnanimity and power of forgiveness will shine as beacons for decades and centuries to come. For the story of Nelson Mandela's special relationship with Scotland is also a tribute to the role of this nation's anti-apartheid campaigners played in contributing to the demise of the apartheid regime. Now, Mandela was regarded by a terrorist as many and was an uncomfortable subject for the majority who actually sat on the fence on apartheid. But in Glasgow, a small group of activists had been active from the 60s onwards in trying to assist the ANC, and as Mandela was increasingly singled out as a symbol of the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, the campaign began to gain traction. Now, Mandela was granted the freedom of Glasgow in 1981, an example which many cities followed, and a declaration was launched the following year, signed by 2,500 city mayors, calling for Mandela's release from prison. For that reason, it's a story which Scotland can be justly proud. The Mandela connection reaffirms Scotland's great tradition of political internationalism. Now, perhaps Scotland's greatest reward for allying itself with Mandela's battle against apartheid is a collective sense of national decency, such a positive role engendered. Now, this is an important point to remember with great relevance for today and for this year's theme for Commonwealth Day. Support for far-right politicians is unfortunately increasing worldwide, and that should be of huge concern to those of us who actually value peace and prosperity for all wherever we live. And as Europe grapples with the defining issue of our age, the largest refugee crisis since the end of the Second World War, the growth in inequality and the impact of climate change, now more than ever, nations across the world must work together. In opposing apartheid, Scotland revealed itself as a nation capable of displaying the qualities needed in laying claim to be a tolerant, caring, peace-building and multicultural society. As well as upholding its values in its own member states, the Commonwealth clearly has that potential to be a hugely influential voice in the wider international community. The diversity of the Commonwealth, its membership, taking in some of the smallest states in the world, as well as some of the largest, and including both very poor countries and some of the richest, must be seen as a particular strength. It's important, therefore, Presiding Officer, that we continue to affirm our commitment to work together as a diverse community of nations, individually and collectively. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. McMillan. Well, Margaret Mitchell, followed by Kenneth Gibson. Ms. Mitchell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Commonwealth Day is officially celebrated annually on the second Monday in March, and the Scottish Parliament holds a debate to recognise the importance of the Commonwealth as soon as possible thereafter. So I thank Stuart McMillan for using his members' debating time to bring this motion to the Chamber this evening. The theme for Commonwealth Day this year is a peace-building Commonwealth. And in this time of world uncertainty and instability, this theme is particularly relevant. The Commonwealth is a family of 53 nations stretching across all continents. It's a unique organisation of members with a shared history, eminently suited to work together to deliver that peace-building objective. The values and aspirations which unite the Commonwealth are democracy, human rights, and the rule of law. The Commonwealth Parliamentary Association was founded in 1911 and consists of 180 branches which operate across 9 regions, of which our BMIR branch, the British Isles and Mediterranean region, is one. In October 2016, the 7th Secretary General of CPA, Akbar Khan, took up his post, and since then he has hit the ground literally running. And it's therefore an honour for our branch that within months of his appointment to this demanding job, he has chosen to be here in Scotland to listen to this Commonwealth debate this evening, and that Dr. Chowdhury, Chair of CPA, has been here in Parliament today meeting with MSPs. The SPA's remit is to connect, develop, promote and support parliamentarians in order to identify good governance and implement the values of the Commonwealth. Enabling good governance and peaceful transition of power is clearly crucial if international peace and security is to be maintained. And here, for the remainder of the time available to me, I want to focus on my remarks on the Commonwealth Women's Parliamentary Association, which was founded in 1989 to increase the number of female elected representatives in parliaments and legislatures across the Commonwealth and ensure that women's issues are brought to the fore in parliamentary debate and legislation. As a member of the CWP-BIMR steering group, last month I took part in the International Working Group of CWP at Wilton Park in Sussex. Wilton Park is a very special conference centre which promotes peace and reconciliation, and it was against this backdrop of consensus building that the working group met and took important decisions which embody Commonwealth Day's peace building theme. Increasing female representation in the Commonwealth parliaments is CWP's main goal, but the working group, taking into account the huge diversity and complexity of the issues facing parliamentarians in the CWP member states, also focused on our key agreed priorities for the next 3 years. These included ending violence against women by adopting a zero-tolerance approach to it in whichever form it takes. Crucially, it was stressed that tackling this issue must be recognised not as an additional spend, but rather as an investment in promoting peace, stability and economic growth. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, parliamentarians throughout the Commonwealth are keenly aware that tackling this issue of violence against women, wherever it takes place, whether in the home, in war zones, or in the worrying levels of abuse directed through the internet, is an essential prerequisite to strengthening international peace and security, and that through the effective work for cooperation, the Commonwealth CPA and CWP are ideally placed to take the lead in ensuring that message is heard loud and clear.
Thank you very much. I call Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Joanne Lannan. Mr Gibson.
Presiding Officer, I would like to thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for securing this debating time. Since its creation, the Commonwealth has aimed to secure democracy and peace in its member states by promoting values of tolerance, respect and understanding. And the theme of this year's Commonwealth Day is a peace-building Commonwealth, which invites us to reflect on the current state of peace and security within each member state and collaborate even more together on issues of mutual interest. The Commonwealth is a unique international organisation with a fundamental belief in freedom, composed mainly of former component parts of the British Empire. But countries that were never under British rule, such as Mozambique and Rwanda, also see the value of joining and have done so, as has Francophone Cameroon. In the world of sport, nations and territories, no matter how small, can compete in the Commonwealth Games, with Tristan da Cunha, St Helens and Naye, population 312, all sending competitors to the 2014 Glasgow Games. I'm sure we all recall those games very fondly, with Scotland competing in its own right, unlike in the Olympics, doing tremendously well, winning 19 golds, coming fourth, well out of proportion to our population in comparison to Australia, Canada and England. In my constituency, a lasting legacy is a unique new state-of-the-art sports facility, Sports Scotland's National Centre, Inverclyde and Largs, which will open in a few short weeks and help to nurture our future sporting talent. A free association, the Commonwealth does not impose any legal and economic obligations, and each member can withdraw at any time without facing sanctions. But what sets it apart from other intergovernmental organisations is the diversity of member states. From republics and monarchies to small Pacific islands to India, Australia and Canada, the Commonwealth's mission is to build bridges, allowing smaller nations to sit down with their larger counterparts as equals. The Commonwealth offers the opportunity to the least developed member states to negotiate bilateral agreements with more developed countries. In this way, many benefit from strong economic support from the richest Commonwealth member states. However, Commonwealth trade not only helps poorer members, also brings benefits to all members, including here in the UK. Our most important Commonwealth economic partners are Australia, India and Canada, who together invest billions of pounds in the UK annually, the direct result of our strong Commonwealth bonds. Every year, the Commonwealth supports many cultural and economic projects between member states at every level. As a member of the cross-party group in Malawi, I warmly support the Scotland-Malawi partnership, which is a perfect example of the bridges which exist between Commonwealth nations. The partnership celebrates more than 1,000 civic links between all 73 Holyrood constituencies and Malawi. And the University of Edinburgh estimates but as of last year, there are more than 94,000 Scots actively involved in these projects. This outlines the desire of the people of Scotland to open up even more to the rest of the world, something deeply rooted in our culture. In my constituency, three schools are twinned with schools in Malawi, promoting friendship and learning between our two countries. And the Largs St John's Church, as well as our Drossan Presbytery, organise not only solidarity actions such as the collection of clothing, food or medical supplies, they also provide a strong support to their sister churches in Malawi. For instance, Largs St John's Church contributes directly to the economic life of Katalonji, a little village in Malawi, by supporting the development of women's crafts and work training. Presiding Officer, I believe that such examples show why the Commonwealth continues to thrive and resonate with so many people in Scotland today. Many Commonwealth countries still lack basic freedoms, of course, and we cannot be blind to that. The excellent work of the Scottish branch of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is well respected in its sincere efforts to work to make improvements in democratic accountability across the Commonwealth. And it's great to have Akbar Khan, the Secretary-General of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, here with us today. I understand that today he visited Stockbridge Primary School and Holyrood Senior School, along with Deputy Presiding Officer Linda Fabiani. This outreach helped to relay the value of the Commonwealth and discuss democracy and diversity, along with serious topics such as apartheid, climate change, equality and diversity. I commend the work of people at every level, from the international to the very local, which allows the Commonwealth family to exist and develop, regardless of race, nationality or religion.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr Gibson. I call Joanne Lamont, to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Ms Lamont, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I say it's a privilege for me to have the opportunity to participate in this debate, and I congratulate Stuart McMillan in securing it. This week of all weeks, I think we reflected back on the Commonwealth and in the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow, as we saw the Commonwealth baton again sent off on its journey round the world. And it's wonderful to think of this baton traversing continents, which at one point traversed Pollock, Kirkdonald and other bits of the south side of Glasgow. And I think it does remind us of just the real sheer joy of the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow, the friendly games, people coming together, young people from across the world coming together and competing and operating at the very highest levels and showing the world that Glasgow and Scotland can be a wonderful platform for that kind of event and people coming together. And this afternoon I had the privilege to chair an event of the Scotland branch of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association with Mr Akbar Khan, the Secretary General of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, along with students and young people from right across Scotland. And I have to say to you, it was a fabulous event, hugely thought-provoking and challenging about what the Commonwealth now means. And the young people were there with many, many ideas and thoughts on what that relationship should be. And I was grateful to have the opportunity to be there. And when we think of the Commonwealth, I don't think we can stress too heavily in its importance, a time of great insecurity, of a world that feels increasingly fragile, a world that feels less safe than it was even 5-10 years ago. And there could be no more appropriate time than to have as its theme a peace-building Commonwealth, where at global level we look to see our communities outward-looking, reaching out to each other and finding ways of cooperating. And that message of peace-building is relevant at a global level. It's also relevant at a community level, but also in our own homes. And I'm particularly pleased on the emphasis on the issue of domestic abuse, because can we be free as a country if any one of us is not safe and secure in our own homes? And I think that message of security and safety has a message that is globally understood, but is also critically locally realised. And of course, the scale of the Commonwealth family is massive. 2.4 billion people, one third of the world's population, 60% of them under 30. The reality is the Commonwealth is a young, vibrant organisation, not a relic of past glories, but something that speaks to the best in our international capacity to cooperate. And it is a new relationship. Those of us of a certain vintage, we can almost reach back and touch the colonial past with which the Commonwealth is associated. And in the past, perhaps, first world countries helping and supporting those within the developing world. And that sense of helping and supporting is still relevant. And we see these very significant partnerships in places but in Malawi, for example. But we also have to recognise this is now a modern relationship. The power of the Commonwealth to give voice to tiny little countries in the issue of climate change, countries which don't cause the damage but are in the front line of suffering from that damage, are given voice by the Commonwealth. But also, so many of these countries, now modern, thriving, innovative economies that we need to work and trade with and have proper respect for and learn from. These are an important modern relationships which have given away the past of that colonial relationship. But finally, I would say uniquely, the Commonwealth it has potential to trade, but it's not a trading bloc. That is not its point. It's not a supranational organisation, but centrally it's a voluntary Commonwealth of its peoples. Not its governments, not the state, but of its people. And it's a potential to stand strong in these fragile times for very important values of democracy, of gender equality, of the separation of powers, of the rule of law, celebrating diversity, development and democracy. There can be no more important time to recognise the strength of the Commonwealth, not as something to celebrate simply of its past, but utterly relevant in these times now. And can I thank everyone in the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association and at Scotland's branch for all it does to ensure these values are enduring.
Thank you very much. I call Alexander Stewart, followed by Maurice Corrie. Mr Corrie is the last speaker in the open debate. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. May I start by congratulating Stuart McMillan on securing this debate and thank him for raising the subject of the Commonwealth Day in the Scottish Parliament this evening. While very diverse, the family of nations that makes up the Commonwealth are united by a common ties and shared history. And as we've heard, a third of the population around the world, 2.4 billion people, are involved in the Commonwealth. And they work locally, they work nationally, and they work globally. The Commonwealth helps to strengthen these bonds, and its member states work together on a global force of good. And that force is recognised, respected throughout the world. The values that are shared by the member states of the Commonwealth, with which can be found the Commonwealth Charter, are ones which I'm sure we can all share these values: human rights, the rule of law, and democracy, and the fundamental building blocks of free and a tolerant society. These, Deputy Presiding Officer, are areas that we work together to ensure. These shared values are also the heart of this year's Commonwealth Day theme, a peace-building Commonwealth. What a wonderful theme to have. It brings together youths and all ages of individuals throughout the Commonwealth to work for peace. And that's something that we would all want to strive for. The very nature of the Commonwealth, which unites some very different countries, and its force for good and stability in very uncertain times to which we live in. The world is much more a dangerous place than it was some time ago. And as we move to the future, we're not quite sure where we are going. But the strength of the Commonwealth pulls together the nations, pulls together the people, and that gives us strength. Like others today in the debate, I would also like to pay tribute to the work of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. May also thank the Secretary General, Mr. Abakan, for being here this evening. I think that is testament to us here in Holyrood. To have you here with us this evening gives us pride and respect in what we are trying to achieve, and we thank you for coming along this evening. As a new member of the Scottish Parliament, I have been extremely impressed by the acts that take place across parliamentary democracy, across the Commonwealth nations, and ensure that they play a very active role in developing member states. I'm delighted to be one of the co-chairmen of the all-party group on Malawi, and I've been astounded by the organisations, the individuals, the projects that are taking place, over 1,000 here in Scotland, and they're all to be congratulated and commended for what they're trying to achieve and building bridges and building opportunities for young and old in the countries which they come from. With my background in local government, I know the importance of looking for examples of good practice and best practice. And I see that here in the authorities and what's happening across the parliamentary level, Deputy Presiding Officer, and that is to be welcomed. the exchanging of information, the sharing of experiences among members and different legislative access throughout the Commonwealth gives profound positive impact on parliamentary democracy. And that's what we want to see. I'm delighted that Margaret Mitchell talks about the women's end, because I think that's a vital role, and we have to encourage more women to participate across the Commonwealth and across the parliamentary process. In that regard, I'd also like to think that the minority government values the work of the CPA and everybody that we have in moving forward. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, the work of the Commonwealth and the nations does on a day-to-day basis both enrich our lives and promote stability in times, as I say, of uncertainty around the world. Following on this year's Commonwealth Day, I am sure that everyone across this chamber will welcome its achievements, and I wish the Commonwealth continued success. It does prove that the Commonwealth plays a very important part, a very vital part, and that part is still very alive and living today. When the Commonwealth was started, it started in a very different era, but it's very relevant for today, and today's people want to participate, want to be involved, so I wish it continued success. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stuart. I call Maurice Corrie, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to thank Stuart McMillan for bringing forward this members' debate to mark this very important day of Commonwealth Day. The Commonwealth is a unique creation. It is a group of diverse nations from across the planet that are united, as the motion says, in the shared values of peace, democracy and equality. So it is only right that it has to be marked here in the Scottish Parliament. The Commonwealth Charter's 16 values and principles, from democracy and human rights, all the way through to the issues to do with access to health and education, are all key to the success of the Commonwealth. They provide a guideline of what necessary building blocks are for a successful, vibrant, democratic state to exist in the 21st century. It is part of the reason why the expansion of the Commonwealth to other countries should be welcomed, such as with Rwanda, which joined in 2009, and Suriname, which in 2012 applied to join. It is a sign that whilst in some parts of the world those shared values I mentioned earlier seem to be in full retreat, in others they are still being embraced and put into action. And I want to turn and mention a part of the special bond which binds the Commonwealth together, which means a great deal to me and in my role as a convener of the cross-party group for Armed Forces and Veterans Community. Watching the unveiling of the Afghanistan and Iraq Memorial in London last week, I was reminded of those I served with, which included members and servicemen and women from the Commonwealth countries in operations overseas. It's worth reminding people in this country that citizens of the Commonwealth freely join our military forces and they serve a vital role. Thousands are serving in the Army, the Royal Air Force and the Royal Navy currently. They serve with distinction and honour. And for example, Sergeant Johnson Bahari, born in Grenada, who won the Victoria Cross in Iraq some years ago. Their contribution to our military should be welcomed and celebrated. They join because the Commonwealth truly does matter, and they share their values, which are worth defending. And from Banff to Bathgate, from Inverness to Inverary, there are war memorials throughout our country with the names of the fallen from several Commonwealth nations and countries inscribed on these memorials. In conclusion, I firmly believe that the Commonwealth is one of the world's greatest institutions and one that is certainly worth celebrating and defending. And this certainly has been endorsed today by the presence in Parliament of the Secretary General of the CPA, and we really do appreciate his presence here today with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Corrie. I call on Alistair Allen to close to the Government Minister. 7 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like others, can I firstly thank Stuart McMillan for allowing the Parliament today the opportunity to celebrate the importance of the Commonwealth family of nations and to emphasise the mutual benefits that are provided by maintaining and enhancing our existing unique relationship with the independent countries around the world that make up the Commonwealth. Can I give apologies from the Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop, who would be here but for a long-standing engagement, and also can I, like others, welcome to the gallery Mr. Akbar Khan, the Secretary General of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, and likewise pay tribute to the very important work that that organisation does. The Commonwealth Charter explicitly recognises that in an era of changing economic circumstances and uncertainty, new trade and economic patterns and unprecedented threats to peace and security, as well as a surge in popular demands for democracy, human rights and broadened economic opportunities, the potential of and need for the Commonwealth has never been greater, both as a compelling force for good and as an effective network for cooperation and for promoting development. That description of a time of rapid and unsettling change sounds familiar to all of us living in 2017, and it emphasises that the values of democracy, human rights and the rule of law enshrined in the Charter remain values that every generation needs to cherish. These were points made, among many others, by Margaret Mitchell, Alexander Stuart, Lewis MacDonald, Maurice Corrie and others in today's debate. And indeed, the First Minister has outlined and underlined our unequivocal support for these values as represented in such other documents as the European Convention on Human Rights. And we are doing everything within our power to defend the Human Rights Act that gives it effect domestically. Our programme for government commits to exploring how we can go further in giving effect to the economic, social and cultural rights set out in UN and other international treaties. And Scotland's international framework outlines a strong emphasis on working with our fellow Commonwealth countries to achieve this. And we will consistently and constantly strive to build, maintain and strengthen these relationships, both through formal trading relationships, which yielded £2.7 billion of exports to the Commonwealth in 2015, and through a greater awareness of each other's culture, allowing us to unlock the wealth of reciprocal benefits. But as Kenneth Gibson and Joanne Lamont rightly identified, these are by no means the only benefits of the Commonwealth, and the Commonwealth Games is perhaps the most visible manifestation of the Commonwealth. And Scottish ministers made it clear that the Games' values of humanity, equality and destiny are universal and cherished here in Scotland. The 2014 Games in Glasgow allowed ministers to actively promote a positive vision of human rights, and we sought to raise issues with visiting nations where appropriate, working with stakeholders to put human rights at the heart of the Games through awareness raising. And in doing this, we welcomed the organising committee's human rights policy statement and provided £25,000 of funding for Pride House in Glasgow during the Games. As part of our efforts to promote these Commonwealth values, the Scottish Government supports various projects, including the Beyond Borders Women in Conflict 1325 Fellowship. This provides training to 50 women annually from international conflict areas to reaffirm and enhance the role of women in the prevention and resolution of conflict. So, promoting equality in parallel with our Commonwealth partners is certainly also a core component of our international development work, with work in Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia aligned to the 16 United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. One such goal states the need to achieve gender equality and to empower all women and girls. And all projects delivered using the International Development Fund will need to demonstrate how they have embedded these goals in their work. And so I welcome Mr. Gibson's reference to the links which in particular, the Scotland-Malawi partnership represent between the peoples of Scotland and Malawi. Since 2005, we've allocated over £58 million to development initiatives, provided humanitarian assistance and improved energy access for 80,000 people as part of our long-standing special link with Malawi, a relationship which, of course, dates back to the works of missionaries and Dr. David Livingstone, but also looks to the future as well in our new cooperation agreement, which is planned. And I, in doing so and in preparing that, I will now be aware, and I was not, in a way I was not previously, of the role that Greenock Morton Football Club plays in Malawian society. But we've also recently opened a new funding round for Zambia and Rwanda, inviting Scottish-based organisations to develop projects to contribute to the global fight against poverty and inequality. Our work in India and Pakistan further strengthens our commitment to sustainable development, with the Scottish Government working with Scottish and local partners in areas such as clean water, sanitation and sustainable energy. Now, this work and these connections are evidenced by the Pakistan-Scottish scholarship scheme for women in higher education, which was introduced by the Scottish Government in 2013 in collaboration with the British Council, and has enabled hundreds of young people from disadvantaged backgrounds to study. So, as a number of members have alluded to, we live in somewhat uncertain times, and as the United Kingdom progresses towards its exit from the European Union, it becomes even more important to maintain and strengthen the relationships with independent countries across the world, which comprise the Commonwealth, and to strengthen the friendships that exist between the peoples of the Commonwealth. This becomes more important than ever it was to provide stability in these times of uncertainty. Scotland remains as passionate as ever about our place in the Commonwealth, and we will remain a committed member of the Commonwealth family of nations.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.